fellas. Welcome back to my channel. This is Tony, aka One Leet One Day. If you're new here, this channel will do one leet code per day following the pattern of topics or series. Basically, I'm doing one leet code one day with you guys together that I've never attempted before. You heard that right. There's no prescripted answer. We're on the same page here. But don't you worry, I got your back, and I promise that I will submit at least an average performance code at the end of each video. Here's a little bit about myself. I come from a non-computer science background, so I'm no better off than most, if not all of you guys, in terms of coding knowledge. But that is okay. It's all about learning on the go. You can think of this video as a first-person gameplay of cracking leet codes. And who doesn't like first-person gameplays, right? So without further ado, let's start today's coding problem. Today we are on series 1, everything about dynamic programming, and I think this is the 6th video in that series. And we're working on problem 213, house robber 2. Remember last time, yesterday we did house robber, so I am guessing this one is similar to that, but maybe a little bit more difficult or maybe rich in terms of content. Anyway, let's take a look. Okay, house robber 2. Description: you are a professional robber planning to rob houses along the street. Each house has a certain amount of money stashed. All houses in this place are arranged in a circle. Okay, that is the new thing, that there is like a circle instead of just a line with a beginning and an end. That means the first house is the neighbor of the last one. Okay, so it's like a ring, close ring. Meanwhile, adjacent houses have a security system connected, and it will automatically contact the police if two adjacent houses were broken into on the same night. Right. Given an integer array nums representing the amount of money of each house, return the maximum amount of money you can rob tonight without alerting the police. Okay, so the difference is that now the first house is connected to the last house, next to, right? And for this one, because it's now a ring, it's like a triangle, and you can really only rob one house, and that is going to be house number 3. Makes sense. And if there's 4 houses, it's going to be like a square, right? A square, you can only take 2 diagonals. So you either take 1, 3, or you take 2, 1. So you're going to take 1, 3, which is going to return you 4. Right. And we also have some constraints, a number of houses in that ring for between 1 and 100, and the amount of money stored in each house between 0 and 1,000. Okay, great. So this is something similar to yesterday's problem. And if we recall what yesterday's problem was, 198, this was yesterday's problem. We had n houses, and then we try to maximize the reward of robbing some of those n houses. And we derived our dynamic programming Bellman principle relationship, recursive relationship for that. So now today we're going to create a solve a new problem, a similar but new problem. So how do we maybe extend our knowledge from what we did last time to this new problem here? Let's give it a try. Okay, so let's maybe just copy and paste whatever was there from yesterday's problem. We're gonna basically copy this relationship in purple because it's like an improved version of the recursive relation. So we're gonna copy this, okay? Copy, and we go to our new document. And this is what we had last time for the houses in a row problem, right? That's 198. That's leet code 198. And now we need to find our new relation here. So what's new here? Previously we could say that you can have this recursive relationship because you can split however many number of houses in the following way. Let me demonstrate, because there's two choices of jumping or not jumping houses. So for example, previously when we had an array of 5, say, we had houses 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. We could either, take the first one and then try to combine it with the maximum reward of these remaining houses, or we could skip the first one and then we just take the reward, maximum reward of all the houses but the first one. So this was like in a row, in a row, houses in a row. But now things are different, right? I'm going to make a line of separation. So this is now houses in a ring. So how does that affect our relation here? For example, let's focus on R5, okay? And now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We can still start on deciding whether we're gonna take one or not. Let's say if we take one, then of course we cannot take two, so we're gonna take the remaining of 3, 4. But now, because 5 is next to 1, we can only take 3 and 4. Or if we skip number 1, I think we got this. If we skip number 1, then we're gonna then just jump directly to the remaining costs of the remaining maximum reward for all the houses except number 1. But is that true? Because I think what you do in terms of this is that you can actually take, because you decided to skip number 1, this effectively breaks the ring of houses into like a row of houses. So this is like a row of houses, because the start and end will never touch. And now this is gonna reduce to exactly the same problem like yesterday. So yep, it's like that. And even for this, even for this, even for the first option, and once you take number 1, you basically made number 2 and number 5 unavailable. And everything except for 1, 2, and 5 is still available. And of course, this is also a row of houses. And we're going to, resort to, similar algorithms like the one we did previously. So for these ones, we're going to use the same computation again. So really, it's just the first step that we need to be special, right? So we're going to say we only need a special first step here. We just need a special first step here. Special first step here. Right. So for the special first step, we need to break. The different behavior is like, okay, for even for the second one, for the second option, this is like exactly the same as that, right? Yeah, so indeed, this is like very similar to what we did last time, only a few, with only a few exceptions. Now, of course, you're gonna do it like a max to close the Bellman's principle of optimality. You do the same here. So the only difference between the houses in a row and houses in a ring is that for the first option in the second case, you're gonna, instead of taking 3, 4, 5, you're gonna just take 3, 4, right? So that's just one change in our code. I think we just need to perform that one little change in our code, and we're done. I'm gonna just highlight that with the color red. I don't know why I cannot click on the colors. It's weird, but yeah. Let's just say we only need to. The only difference you see is between this and this here. That is the only difference between these two types of problems, right? So this is problem color, yeah. This is problem 198, and this is houses in a ring, and this is problem. Today's problem is Leet code 213. So yeah, that's the only difference. The only difference is here. Let's just highlight that. Only difference. Right. And right, let's use that. And let's highlight, you know, that is the only difference here. Okay, so with that being said, we go back to our code and we can reuse yesterday's code and implement this only difference. All right, let's go back to our code. Leet 198, that's exactly what it is. We're going to create a new notebook though. And we're going to copy today's Leet code description, house robber number 2. This is a markdown. 213, house robbers number 2. And this is the description. Let's just take one of the examples. Okay. And then we're going to take the code. We take the code from Leet 198 and modify upon it. Right. So that's exactly what we do. 198, we're going to take the last one, which is supposedly the most elegant version. And then we're going to use that as a baseline. Also, let's just change the name of our notebook to 213. Right. So that was that. And let's just also build some test cases as well. So for the test cases, this time we're going to update our test case with the new ones. So what is that? Like if it's 2, 3, 2, we're expecting 3. if it's, yeah, actually we can include these ones too. Right, 232, but let's just see what I should do for that one. For this one, I should be taking 4 exactly. And for this one, well, this is really hard to tell, but we're not sure. So let's just say if it's 232, we should be expecting 3 only. Right. For this one, we can expect 4. For this one, we can only expect 3. Yeah. So how do we change that? The trick here is really that when we're doing that recursive dynamic programming, a relation, we need to, for the first step, right? For the first step, when we initialize it, let's just actually write this in terms of equations to be 100% clear on what we're doing, right? So previously, this purple line was that expression. So for the first step in our case, we're gonna do right. Let's just write it down like that. R5 equals to the max of. Here we have. So RK plus 1, right? That's like R2, right? That's the second case here. And the next one is R of 1. Oh, sorry. I think I just did a mistake. This should be R1 instead of R5 because that is the consistent notation of it. We're gonna do the same here. It just means we're starting from house number 1 onwards. Same thing here. 1. Right, and then it's gonna be equal to R2, the maximum between R2 or R1, that is taking the first house, plus capital R of 3, but careful, this is like a special capital R of 3 because, you know, we're going to have to use 3 and 4 because now, since you have taken that route, you are basically now discarding 2 and 5 from the list, right? But then down here, yeah, you're still doing 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's a different R, right? It's a different R, and this R here, it has a different ending point. How are we going to deal with that? Because for the calculation of this is basically on a different list now, and I guess we cannot just remember two values because these are basically two branches of values that we need to remember so. How about this? How about I name? How about I rename this? Instead of saying R, we're gonna rename it. We're gonna say this is. Yeah, this is R2. because we need to make a different, we need to speak to work on a different array here. So it's going to be R2, and what R2 means is that it means the right, it means basically that the array of houses without the last one, right? Without the last one. Yes. Right. And without the last one, right. So without the last one, how do we do it? Well, we can do, so basically we need to now store two different indices. One is R and one is R2. And for right, and we're going to be propagating down that line quite a bit. So that's fine. So R2, let's just, you know, define what R1 is. R is corresponding to this original 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 houses list. R2 is just 1, 2, 3, 4 without 5. Right. And then once we propagate these down, right, so of course R2 is going to base on, we can reuse this equation, you know, from now on. And so for R2, it can be calculated as R2 equals the maximum between R of 3 and R of 2 plus capital R of 4. Right. Right, that's right. So going down this line, we can just reuse the original expression here as in purple. For this one here, R23, it'll be interesting, but let's see. R2 of 3, because it's again still like a row of houses, not a ring of houses. We can apply the same purple relationship, I think, but now we need to replace R with anywhere R with R2. So R2 of 4, right? And now we can use the same R, then R of 3 plus R2 of 5. Well, R2 of 5 does not exist, right? So, because R2 of 5 does not exist, this is just going to be 0. But it's still going to take the maximum of R2 between R2 of 4, which is, you know, just R4, and as well as R3. So yeah, so that is that. I think we just need to keep these two dictionaries to store the capital R values. And you can see, if we're working backwards, we only need to remember two of them values, right? So let's just go back to the code here and see how can we improve it. So for now, when we build up the tree, when we build up the backward calculation, we need to build two dictionaries. So there's going to be like an R2. Dictionary, for for the list of houses, except the last one, right? So now we calculate backwards. And we're like propagating RK from the last one, right? From the last one all the way down to RK equals to zero. Yeah. Because you know n is the length of this array, so n minus 1 is literally the index of the last element. So yeah, we can say rk plus 2 equals to the value of the last house. And if that is the case, like if we only have n equals to 1, then we basically just return that house, the only house value. Okay, then if we have two or more than two houses, we can have this relationship to build it up, right? So this is the recursive relationship that we have been talking about. It's a general expression. Okay, so yeah, RK plus 1, that is the first of the two values that we store in our dictionary. It then becomes the maximum between the two, the last two, maximum between the two, the last two elements. Right, and then if we stop there, we just return rk as rk plus 1. Right, and if n is greater or equal to 3, that is where the fun begins, because now we do have general recursion relationships. And instead of just updating it once, we need to like update R and R2 like at the same time, right? Right. So yeah, so that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna build up R and R2 at the same time. But this time, you know, R2 it starts from M minus 2. But this only happens when you have more than, you know, at least two elements. So this actually can wait until later, as in here, right? So this is when you start to update R2, k plus 2. Yeah. And if you only have two of those values, then yeah, your R dictionary will have two entries. One is k plus 1, one is k plus 2. But your R2 dictionary will only have one entry, that is R2, k plus 2. And it will end there. So for your R2 to also have an entry with the key k plus 1, you need your n at least at least 3, right? So you're going to have your R2, k plus 1, and that should be equal to this n minus 3, right? So then you have a complete set of two values in your R2 dictionary, right? And then you're going to start that general for loop where you use that DP recursive relationship to drag down your values. That is right. And what are we missing here? I think we have like a dual storage. We have dual storage rather than, you know, one storage, because we need to propagate R2, backpropagate R2, and we need to also backpropagate R at the same time. And once we backpropagate R and R2, we can then, you know, have a more general expression of R all the way down to R1, right? So let's see. What are we looking at here? In this expression, we have both R and R2. But for most R and R2. Right. So in our world, we need to calculate R up to, we need to calculate our R up to this point. Let's just use that rainbow color again. We need to calculate our R up to this point here. We need to calculate our R2 up to this value here. Well, for this, we're using the one indexing. So in reality, during our coding, since we're using zero indexing, we need to calculate capital R of 1 and capital R2 of 2, right. So in that sense, we need to have at least how many elements? We need to have quite a few more elements, right? So anyways, we'll keep propagating those. And then we'll keep updating those. Keep updating R and R2. Right. We keep updating those four values that we need to store for each iteration. And where do we stop? So, I think we don't stop at here, because if we put minus 1 here, k is going to stop at 0. And we don't really want to stop there, because for the last step, there's like a special treatment where we need to combine both R and R2 for our calculation. So we're going to let it stop at where? At for R2, we need this to stop at 2. For R, we need this to stop at 1. Yeah, unfortunately that's the case. Right. So yeah, we're not gonna stop there. We're gonna stop it at number 2. If we say number 1, it's going to stop at 2. If we say 0, it's going to stop at 1. Actually, you cannot put it at 0. So if we put the value Well, the reason why we cannot put a 0 here is because the range function does not accept 0 as the third input. So you have to put it either 1 or minus 1 or other values, but not 0. So if we put it at 1, then k is going to stop at k equal to 2. And that is all good for R2 because that's exactly where we want it to stop. So for k equals to 2, that's the last value we want for R2 to update. So after that, we have a remaining task of, you know, update R for, you know, k equals to 1. We still have to do that like manually. So let's just do that manually. Let's say we do rk equals that, so we update that, and then right, and then we do an update on our rk plus 1 and rk plus 2, right? And then lastly, we're gonna, you know, expression for k equal to 0, right? So for k equal to 0, we're going to have rk equals, now we can use that max of, we can use this expression here, capital R of 1, right? Which is, in our case, k plus 1, because now this k plus 1 here, it at this point, you know, because k equal to 1, this rk is like r1, right? And then this rk plus 1, it will mean actually r1, because yeah, this is r1. So max r1, and then nums of 1, right? Like the first value. But this is 1 indexing. We're going to use 0 indexing. So it's nums 0, the first one, right? Because this indicates this case where we actually take the first house. And then plus R2. Remember, now we're going to need to use R2 instead of R. R2 of what? R2 of 3. But in our world, in the zero indexing world, it's R2 of 2. And what is that? R2 of 2, well, we're going to look at, you know, the last step when we were in the for loop. So this for loop stopped at, you know, k equals to 2, remember? So right, so yeah, we should use this notion here. And R2 of k, that is when, you know, k equals to 2, and the value was assigned to R2k plus 1. So we're going to use that. So it's going to be R2k plus 1, like that. Right. So I think that's it. That is the new relationship that we just built. I think it'll work, but it's just that, you know, I think... So here's the problem. This for loop goes from... takes k from m minus 3 all the way down to 2, But what if n minus 3 is actually less than 2? Then that becomes a problem, right? Yeah, unfortunately. So, excuse me. So, in order for n minus 3 to be, at least 2, then n minus 3 has to be greater or equal to 2, n has to be greater or equal to 5. So this we have to say n greater or equal to 5. Wow, so we're missing, we need to, perform two steps in intermediate there. Unfortunately, right? So we're gonna need to compute what happens when n is exactly 3. We need to make that case, and we need to make that case here now. So let's just create a new blueprint, and then we're gonna go from there. So we're gonna work out the case of oops, clicked on the wrong thing. Sorry about that. We need to work out what happens when n equals to 3 and n equals to 4 in order to fill the gap. So let's work out that if our n equals to 3, then our r at 1, right? It's what are our choices? 1, 2, 3. The first choice is that we can, always take the first house, and then we're gonna skip the second one, and then we're gonna take this, but because this is also close to the first one, we're gonna skip that anyway. Or we take the second one, we ditch the first one, and then the one next to the second one, which is the third one. And we take the max of that. Right. So that's n equal to 3. And when it comes to n equal to 4, still we have two cases. 1, 2, 3, 4. We take the first one. That means we're going to skip the second one. And then, right, we also skip the last one and we take this one. Now, what is another choice? Another choice is that we are taking the second one, so we're skipping the first and the one next to the second, which is the third, and we can do whatever with the remainder. So, that being said, actually, no. Sorry, I think we for this one we're making it more complicated than it should be. It should be just, skip the first one and, take the row of houses since the second one. So that's what we do here. Right. Right. This is what we do. So in case of n equal to 3, if we work our way backwards, let's see. We build our way backwards, right? And we already have built what an two capital R's and one capital R2. Right. So previously we have already built two capital R's. And one capital R2. And what they meant in this in this case, it meant right, this k plus 2, it definitely meant you know, the last one, right? So that means 3. And then k plus 1, this is of course 2. And then R2, because by definition R2 means the array where we don't have the last element, so this must mean, you know, 2, the second house, starting from the second house. Yep. So we still need to, you know, maximize. In this case, we still need to perform this relationship, meaning we still need to take R k plus 1 and as well as R 2 k plus 1. But in this case, what is our R 2 k plus 1? Well, in this case, our R 2 k plus 1 is simply so let's give it a try. Our R2 of k plus 1 is now simply the first house, right? So it's basically the first house. Yep. And can we say that the relationship still holds? What relationship? The relationship that, you know, R1 equals to the maximum between, you know, capital R of capital R of k plus 1, which is 2, as well as R1 plus R2 of 3, right? Right. Does that still hold? Well, let's see. So what this is, this means R2. Yeah, this is going to point to this one here, and it's the second house. Right, yeah, it's the second house. And well, it's like the remaining maximum value starting from the second house all the way to the end. So it's like basically this part here. And then what is this? This R1 is basically taking this guy here, taking this one here. And then R2-3, what this is, well, it means R2-3, because in this case our R2, it doesn't even have the third element, so this will have to be 0 because it does not exist, right? In R2 we only have two, you know, two houses, so the third house is basically non-existent. So in our case, we can still reuse this relationship. It's just that now that R2-3 cannot exist yet. Okay, so we're just gonna make a special case. And you know, for our n equal to 3, we're basically going to say that our rk, which is our answer, is going to be the maximum between r k plus 1. We can still use that. We can still use that, right? And R1, yeah, we can still use that. That's nums 0. And plus something empty, so plus 0, right? Yeah. But do we update anything? Well, we're going to actually update this R2K plus 1, right? So let's do that. R2K plus 1. Now, because we have at least three numbers, R2K plus 1 is going to be basically the first element. So starting from the first element down to, you know, down to the second. So this is going to be, let's see. Yep. R2K plus 1, it becomes, and this is a little bit confusing to me. R2K plus 1 now is R of K, is it K plus 2? No, it's not. It is, you know, it is the maximum between nums m minus 2 and nums m minus 3. Right, that's what R2 is. Yeah. But what about, that's what R2K plus 1 is. But what about R2K plus 2? Is that still this guy? Yeah, it is. So, all right, I think we got this. And for this step, do we need to update? Do we need to update R as well? Well, we are preparing R and R2 basically for this general iterative expression. So let's leave it that way. And okay, I think we can move on. And if there anything goes wrong, we'll come back to it. And greater or equal to 4. So right. So for this case here, n equal to 4. Let's try to rewrite this relationship. Try to, you know, do this again. See if R1 can be expressed with that general relationship. My intuition is that it cannot, because if it can, we can just tuck it into the general case. But anyways, this will be in the first case, actually in the second case, we will just take capital R of 2 as one choice. That is like skipping the first house. Also, if we take the first house, we'll have non-capital R1. And then we will have our R2, which is like the list of house except the last one. And we're going to start from the third house. all the way to the third house. Yeah. So this expression now actually works. And instead of being null or zero, this time R23 is actually just R3. And it's not null anymore. Okay, so everything else stays the same. But then in terms of like the general expression, because if you think about the general expression here of RK equals to maximum of RK plus 1 and R of K plus R2 of K plus 2, you think of this general expression and then look at it here, then you see that now this new RK plus 1, it means R of 2 here in the 1 indexing, and it means R of 1 in the 0 indexing convention. So I think we need to somehow update them, because now because when n is only like greater or equal to 2, or when n is actually just 2, then our R of k plus 1 means R of R of 1, in which case k is 0, and then 0 plus 1 is 1. But now, in this case, our k again, it means 0 in the 0 indexing, and then 0 plus 1 is 1. Okay, it's still the same, right? Still the same. Yeah, it's still the same. So we don't need to update RK plus 1, and we don't need to update RK plus 2. Is that right? Well, we don't even have an R of K plus 2 in this expression. So we have an R2 of K plus 2, and that is R2 of 3, right? So R2 of 3, R2 K plus 2, in this case, you know, when n equals to 4, this becomes 4 minus 2. So it'll be the second to last element. Yeah, it'll be the second to last element, which is nums 2 in 0 indexing, which is R3 in 1 indexing. So I think that is consistent. We don't need to update this. We don't need to update R2 of K plus 2. We don't need to update R of K plus 1 either. We just need to write this expression down. That'll be great, yeah. We just need to write this expression down. Now, this is going to be R2 of what? K plus 2. Right. Right. I think we got it. It's just that, you know, it got a little twisted and kind of super confusing. But I think we're on the right track. So let's say this is correct. And let's try it. Well, this is quite stressful. But hey, we got those correct answers, right? Honestly, I don't know how I landed here, but it just seems as if we are correct. Let's just, try this, run the code, see if it works. It works for that first case. It works for these cases too. Let's try to submit. Oh, okay. There's some runtime error, of course. Local variable k reference before assignment. Okay. I see there's a problem here. For k equal to 1, so you just say nums 1, right? Yeah. We're doing it manually. Wrong answer. Okay, so I'm glad we're giving a evaluation and it says wrong answer. So we can actually use that as our new test case. Rob, this. Yes. So what is this expecting? We expect 3, right? Do we expect 3? Yeah, we expect 3 and we only got 2. And that is a problem. Right. So in that case, we're going to just focus on that problem and work our way through. So I know this is not elegant at all, but let's just focus on this problem, right? 1, 2, 1, 1, and we're gonna use this to find out. Well, 1, 2, 1, 1, that's basically 4 elements. And, right, so let's say it's 1, 2, 1, 1. Right, and let's just work out these calculations as we did it here. So we're gonna do R1. R1 equals to max of R of 2 and R1 plus R2 of 3. And how much is that? Well, this equals to max between R of 2. Well, R of 2, if we look at this here, it means that we start from the second one and we treat it as a row of houses and how much we can get out of it. And that should be 3, right? Yeah, it should be 3. And then whatever R1 is 1 plus R2 of 3. R2 of 3 meaning start from 3, and we actually only have this one choice. So it should be like that. So this is actually 3. Right. So when we calculate R2, we should get a value of 3. So somehow, somewhere, when we're dealing with this case, we're not getting RK plus 1 equal to 2, right? No, we're not. So let's just use the breakpoint debugger to find out what is wrong there. And actually, let's start from here. Okay. Start from the very beginning. And here we go. This is where we are. So R right now is empty. R2 is empty. And if we step, we see that now our R has a k plus 2 equal to 1. Yes, and then this line 14 works only when, you know, n stops at 1. So now n greater or equal to 2. Now we're going to have a value for r k plus 1. And that is also 1. Which makes sense because they simply mean capital R K plus two. It should be like the last house, the value of the last house, and R capital R of K plus one should be basically like the larger between the last two houses, which is still 1. And so this R K plus 1 value makes sense. And then for the next row, we're calculating R2 of K plus 2, which should be the second to the last house value, which should be 1. And that is exactly R2, exactly what it did. Right, and then we are calculating RK, just for the case if n stays at 2. Now we move on to n greater or equal to 3. And now we update R2 k plus 1. And what does that mean? Basically, that means, okay, we cut off the last house. And then we're trying to find out k plus 1, k plus 2. So we're finding out, like, the maximum house value of robbing any of the houses between this one and this one, and that is clearly a value of 2. So if we perform that, we should have R2 of k plus 1 should be equal to 2, and that is correct. And then we move on to the RK value for just the case of n equal to 3. And it's whatever it is, we don't really worry about that yet. Now here's the interesting part. When n equals to 4, this is where we're at. We're calculating this now, guys. So we should just compare this expression with what we have here. So ideally we should be comparing R2 and this expression and take the maximum. R2 in terms of in a general expression, it becomes R of K plus 1, which is the case here, and R2's value should be 3. Is that the case? K plus 1. Well, that's the problem. So we're expecting R K plus 1 to actually be R2 for our problem, which is now the value, the maximum value of the last 3 houses. So that means we definitely are missing a update step for building up RK and RK plus 1. We forgot to, properly update them using this update equation somewhere between step number 2 and step number 4. I think that's what we're missing. Like, when n is equal to 2, it's perfectly fine to say that R of k plus 2 equals to the last element, and R of k plus 1 equals to the maximum between the last two elements if n equal to 2, and that's it. But when we move on to n equal to 3, we basically need to update the meaning of what k plus 1 and k plus 2 is. And I think we just missed that step. So we're definitely going to add that here. Let's just take off the debugger for now. And we know what we're missing here. So update basically the meaning of those things. Right, update the meaning of those things. So when we move from n equal to 2 to n equal to 3, now we need to roll these values. Like this. Yeah. So basically, what was before R k plus 1 become the current R k plus 2. And for the new k plus 1, it'll have to be let's say the result of, you know, maximizing maximizing three houses. So that means, right, we need a recursive relationship here. Let's see. Yeah, it's a little bit messy, but we'll get it. We just need to calm down and walk through this together. So when n equal to 3, right? When n equal to 3, what does our rk plus 2 mean? Well, our rk plus 2, it is going to mean previously, our RK plus two, it means the last element, and then R of K plus one, it means, you know, the larger of the last two elements. That was when there's only two values. Right. But now we have three values, and the previous RK plus 1, which was the larger of the last two elements, becomes our new RK plus 2, which is, you know, still the larger of the last two elements. But now the new RK plus 1, it'll have to mean the best reward out of the last three elements, which in this case means the largest reward of, you know, trying to walk through all the houses, right? All the three houses. Mm. Yeah, kinda. Right. Okay, let's see. So, RK plus 1 equals to RK. Okay, where are we? We are trying to update what this is. And we have updated the meaning of K plus 2 already, right? And we just need to update again the meaning of K plus 1. So previously R of K plus 2, R of K plus 1 means the larger of the last two. So that's a current RK plus 2. So the current RK plus 1, it would have to mean you would have to mean, maximum between let's say R K plus 2 the new K plus 2, right? And then as well as taking that, actually minus 3 now, and then plus plus what? So it's gonna be taking the first element and then plus the remaining value of the third element. But when I say the third, it means the third element when it's in a row of houses. So, well, this is gonna be two, right? And this is gonna be, in our case, two, and then we need to plus that one there, and so it's gonna be K plus 2. Right, we need the previous R K plus 2 value, which is that. So right, before that is like before we update. That is before we update that. So how about let's do this? Yeah. How about let's do this? I don't know if it's gonna work because honestly, this is so confusing now. Right. Okay, now we actually got this, but I mean, it could be by chance a success. Okay, we still got our answers. I'm just following my best intuition here, and I cannot guarantee that this is a full solution. I think we're still most likely here with an incomplete solution. Run test cases. Submit. Yeah, wrong answer. There we go. So yeah, so this code is still not right. Okay, I think at this point we're not going anywhere down this route, and we'll suck even further if we continue doing this. So now, how about let's take a look at the solution and maybe learn some best practices here. Right. So now, let's look at the solution. I thought this was going to be fast, but apparently we didn't make the transition smooth enough from our previous experience to this one here. So this problem, according to the solution, is a minor extension to the original house robber problem. The only difference is that the first and the last houses are adjacent to each other, and therefore if the thief has robbed the first house, they cannot steal the last house, and vice versa. As hint one in the question suggests, oh, there was a hint? I didn't know there was like a hint. Okay, there's no hint. As hint one in the question suggests, the problem becomes to rob either house 1 minus house m minus 1 or house 2, oh, house 1 to house m minus 1 or house 2 to house n, depending on which choice offers more money. Now the problem has degenerated to the house robber. Okay, that is a pretty good split, you know, by splitting the problem into two sub-problems of house 1 through house n minus 1, and then house 2 through house n. Yeah, I should have done that. Let's do that, okay? Let's do that. Without looking further, let's just modify our code into that. And we're going to actually entirely ditch the code here, and we're going to take this solution from our previous submission again for the house robber original problem, right? And we're going to make it rob. We're gonna name it rob in a row. Rob in a row. Yeah, and we're gonna define a higher level problem called rob. We're gonna do that. And so we're gonna make a special case if nums.len, well, if len nums is equal to 1, right? If it's just a length of 1, we're just going to return nums 0, because that's the only house we're going to rob. Else if length of the nums is 2, well, that is also easy. We're just going to return the maximum between nums 1, nums 0, and nums 1. It is when, you know, length is like greater or equal to 3 when this becomes an interesting problem, right? So we're going to find a solution of what R1, which is self.rob in the row. And we're going to do nums, no, 0 all the way to minus 1, right? Minus 1 is that the last element? Yeah. So maybe we should do minus 2. R2 equals to self dot rob in row nums 0, not 0, but 1 all the way to minus 1. And then we're just going to return the maximum between R1 and R2. Right, that's it. And, you know, just for bookkeeping, we're gonna do that. The documentation, yeah. And I don't know if my expression here is making sense, but okay, it didn't make sense. So let's see how do we write this thing correctly, okay? So let's search Python list first to second last. Yeah, that's what we want to do. First to second last. How do you do that? Getting second to last. Yeah, Python slicing. So how do you slice that? K through none. Perform slicing from K to end. Okay, so none is the one that you need to slice. Okay. Let's see. Test list. This is like 239 from the second to the end, leaving the last element empty using none, or leaving it empty. Python 3 code. Okay, so case to last. Now we got how to do that, like case to last. So we can basically say none, right? That's like the second to the last, right? But what if we want to do it till second to last? Whoa, okay. We're getting some interesting results. There's something probably wrong because you see, like, honestly, I don't know whether this has been called in the correct way. So I'm just going to set up a debug in here and see what our nums are when they're being called. And we're just going to focus on the first problem, okay? Oh, you didn't even call Robin Rowe? Why is that? I feel surprised. The length of num should be like 4, right? So you should probably actually step into that. And you tell me that you didn't really step into that. That's weird. That's very weird indeed. Why are we not even? Where are we not even going into this? Isn't that weird? It is very weird. Let me just restart the kernel. Restart kernel, clear all outputs. And let's just wait, we're gonna need to put some debugger on. And let's put a debugger in here. A breakpoint in here. Right, okay. Now we're here. Nums, let's see. The problem gives 1, 2, 3, 1, and for this first call, we want to do the first element all the way to second to last. So it should be 1, 2, 3, but now we're having 1, 2. So that's definitely a no-no. It seems like we should probably be doing -1 here. Yeah, that seems more correct. Right, this is now a correct answer, but somehow the kernel maybe is still playing something with me. So now I'm going to again use the debugger, excuse me, and to just check and make sure that when we are calling it, our nums list has 3 elements, 1, 2, and 3 exactly. Okay, so now I can trust the results now. And let's just reopen these up for tests. Clear the kernel. Right, so now the results are correct. I believe we have now a submission ready piece of code, and let's just try it. All right, let's just run the code and run it on more test cases, and it worked. Submit. It worked. Okay. Finally, by using some help from the solution, let's just submit again, see if it's a little bit faster. It turned out we are about average in terms of runtime, but we use actually quite a lot more memory than others. Okay. So that is like an average solution, really, just an average solution. I'm sure there are ways to improve it, so probably it's lying there somewhere in the solution, and we can take another look. So for this approach, right, this is the one that we learned from and we implemented. Right, so the complexity. Right, so indeed you have like Rob and Rob Simple. Right. Right, it's exactly the same code as we do have. And the complexity space, it's supposed to be actually good in terms of space complexity. Somehow ours ran pretty slowly. So, not slowly, but took more space. Let's see if the solution actually does better in memory usage. Well, does, become better in Python 3. But only beats about 24% of Python 3 solution online submissions. So it's even though the space complexity is 0.1, it's still not ideal. But is that all? I mean, that's the solution, huh? You can also submit the code in Java. Let's just try to see if we do it in Java, does that get us anywhere better? Well, not really. I see that, for this problem specifically, a lot of people have faster solutions. Faster solutions, have, more memory efficient solutions. Although dynamic programming is fast, I mean, it's fast, and it's even faster in Java, but it, uses a lot more memory. Well, this is the difference between different programming languages, I believe. But yeah, this is pretty impressive. I mean, looking at that. All right, let's go back actually to our own code. And to be honest, today this is a little bit stressful for me because, as we know, as we have seen it, it took me quite a amount of time to attempt on our own iteration logic. Although it kind of makes sense, but I think we made a wrong decision in the first step, trying to generalize the previous bank robber problem, house robber problem into this new ring-shaped house robber problem. And because of that decision on the first step, it really made a big mess down the line for us to generalize the entire code. So with some little help from the solution, which provided a pretty good simplification for the first step, we were able to then quickly implement a solution that reuses yesterday's code and have a similar performance to the solution. And it's an average code. It's an about average code. So that summarizes today's code challenge. Well, it's been a long episode, but definitely we've learned through mistakes, and this is only going to help us later in our next challenges. So thank you guys for sticking along. We've learned an important lesson today, that is, when we try to generalize from previous problems, make sure that that generalization step is made simple, elegant, and easy to implement. So spend a little bit of time during that thinking phase will save you, a ton of time later to avoid getting into messy code, readaptations. So that is the lesson today. We will see each other in the next episode. Peace.